very funny.
As if you're going.
You don't need to mention that.
I will mention that.
Oh, you're on your mic now. Oh, no, maybe.
Good afternoon. Are we ready? Yes, yes. It has been exciting. Week 2015 has been very special. And we are here again for another round of challenging and exciting information, learning, and interaction. But before we go there, I would like to make an announcement. We would like to make you aware of a program update. Program number 614, which is a workshop on Thursday morning. It will be taking place at room C363. And it has the title, A Pedagogical Model to Enhance Reasoning and Action for Environmental and Social Scientific Issues. Please, you are reminded to keep looking up updates online, you know, to be completely up to date. So that's for the announcement. And now I would like to welcome you to this session. Just as an introduction to this session, you know, if you turn on the news, even right now, you would hear a lot of bad news, horrid news, man's inhumanity to man and nature alike. Yet, these may be very difficult times for the global community. But according to Wangari Maathai, the late Wangari Maathai, you know, she said, these are the very times, you know, the difficult times, that is when you have opportunities to make a change. And since this meeting started, it has been a celebration of good news, of women and men taking big and small actions to empower people, raise a new sustainability generation, preserve the environment, and care for one another. One document that succeeded in capturing the basic values, rights, and responsibilities common to humanity is the Earth Charter. Recently, Pope Francis referred to it in his encyclical letter, Laudato Si, on care for our common home. He said, among other things, the Earth Charter asked us to leave behind a period of self-destruction and make a new start. But we have not as yet developed a universal awareness needed to achieve this. Here, I would echo the courageous challenge in the Earth Charter. As never before in history, common destiny beckons us to seek a new beginning. Let us be a time remembered for the awakening of a new reverence for life, the firm resolve to achieve sustainability, the quicken of the struggle for justice and peace, and the joyful celebration of life. And now, let me invite Mirian Vilela, the Executive Director of the Earth Charter. Yes, we have her here. The Executive Director of the Earth Charter International Center on ESD at the University of Peace to engage our minds. And she's going to be speaking on the power of dialogue, visioning, and collaboration, an Earth Charter experience of teaching and learning. Let's give an applause to Mirian. Mirian, would you?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Akpezi, and good afternoon to all of you. I'm very happy to be here today to share with you a couple of thoughts regarding the Earth Charter Initiative experience, specifically focusing on the power of dialogue, visioning, and collaboration. I just came from the Netherlands, as yesterday we were celebrating the 15th anniversary since the launch of the Earth Charter. We had a very special event yesterday, and we're remembering what we did 15 years ago. And the last time I was with this community was at the World Environment Education Congress in Durban. So I'm very happy to be here. And my next stop next week will be in Portugal, as the Portuguese-speaking countries are organizing a similar congress in Portuguese. And given that I'm from Brazil, I will be very happy to bridge the conversations that are happening here to the event in Portugal. So I would like to start with a moment of gratitude. That's a concept that is very much central and part of the Earth Charter also. Gratitude for the gift of life and this notion of our connection with the Earth and the universe. So over the past 20 years, the Earth Charter Initiative has been working to contribute to the awakening, contributing to the awakening of a new global consciousness with regards to humanity relationship among ourselves and the large living world. This awakening emerged, among other things, through shared humanity values, which involves expanding and deepening our understanding and worldview of the place humanity occupies on Earth. Let me start by briefly sharing with you what is the Earth Charter. So on one hand, the Earth Charter is a document and is a movement, an initiative. And as a document, is a declaration that frames a language or fundamental ethical values and principles for building a just, sustainable, and peaceful society. It's the result of an intercultural and multi-sectoral dialogue that took place during the decade of the 90s, trying to answer the question of what are those values and principles that should guide us towards sustainability, or what are those principles that should frame this world vision of sustainability. And that consultation took place in the decade of the 90s, and we launched the Earth Charter in the year 2000. Therefore, it's a sort of a summary of a number of international policy making and principles on international law on sustainability. But the Earth Charter offers a systemic vision of the common good, a systemic vision of the common good, and this notion of Earth's community. It could be seen as a compass. So when Grady Matai was a member of the Earth Charter Commission during the 90s, and she used to share with us this thought of when you are in a forest or when you are in an airport with a lot of things, and you can easily get lost. And therefore, a map or a compass can be very helpful in helping us to find our way or the direction towards common good and this vision of sustainability. So the Earth Charter could be seen or could be used as a compass for giving us a direction to common good, to the common good. So today I'm going to be referring strengthening to the elements of dialogue, language, image, and action, the relationship of that. During the drafting process and also post-drafting process of the Earth Charter, the initiative have been promoting dialogue. And a dialogue that helps us frame a language, as you can see, there, a dialogue that helps us to frame a language, and that language help us to envision and have an image, an old view image of where do we want to go and what is the right relationships we should be promoting on Earth, not only among human beings, but also with the large community of life. And that dialogue that helped to frame a language that helps to give us an image or a vision is the kind of things that awakens and guides us towards action and collaboration. So as you can see there were two moments of the Earth Charter initiative. Between 1991 and the year 2000, there was a dialogue on consultation and drafting process to help us understand what are those shared, identify and understand those shared values and principles to guide us towards a more just, sustainable, and peaceful world. But also post-2000, when the Earth Charter was launched, the dialogue should not stop. Of course it should not stop. It's not that it's there, but this dialogue around what are the values and principles that should guide our actions and our behaviors, it should be part of a reflection to guide us towards a more understanding with the world. So post-2000, the Earth Charter Initiative continues to promote a dialogue among an intergenerational and multicultural dialogue that again helps us to frame this image of what is a just and sustainable world, but also help us with inspiration for action. And this dialogue is helping with the understanding of these shared values that humanity has. And the reason for doing that is that we often are in a crossroads in our decision-making processes that require reflection on the ethical dilemmas we may find. So here is an image that gives us a broad understanding of how is the Earth Charter built. The Earth Charter has a systemic nature that has the ethic of care for the community of life as the heart of it. In the systemic nature, because it sees the relationship among all these four parts that you can see there. There are 16 principles that are organized in four parts. The first one being respect and care for the community of life. The second, ecological integrity. The other one is social and economic justice. And the fourth is the notion of democracy, nonviolence, and peace. Which means that through the lenses of the Earth Charter, the peace agenda is also very much part of the sustainability agenda. Under each of these parts or dimensions of the Earth Charter, there are four principles and a number of supporting principles. Here's a little bit more information about the 16 principles that are organized by color code from ecological integrity, social and economic justice, democracy, non-violence, and peace. I would like to emphasize one vision, an image that the charter articulates that helps us to shift away from a human-centric approach or a national-centric approach to a vision of Earth community. Now, Thomas Berry, Leonardo Boff are thinkers that have been articulating this notion of Earth community as an image. And for me, the question is, what comes to our mind when we hear Earth community? Another thing that, another concept that the Earth Charter is articulating is this notion of community of life. Our relationship not only among ourselves as human beings, but with the large living world, and this notion of community of life. So again, a dialogue that is framing a new language that is helping to frame a new worldview, a new perspective of our relationship with the large living world and seeing us as part of a community of life. Okay, the third concept or principle, and the last one that I wanted to highlight that is part of the Earth Charter, is this notion of common but differentiated responsibility at the same time as universal responsibility. So the Earth Charter invites people to think about ethical values and to expand their ethical consciousness. It provides a vision, as I mentioned, of global ethics, which can be used to promote ongoing reflection and dialogue across different cultural perspectives on common goals and shared vision. Let me just go. So on that one, the Earth Charter clarifies the relationship between universal but differentiated human responsibilities in the sense that common responsibilities should be differentiated according to each person or institution capacity and circumstances to address a challenge. So this kind of dialogue that the Earth Charter Initiative has been promoting is inviting us to think about what are, for instance, our responsibilities to people from other nature, other nations, other cultures, and what are those responsibilities that we should have with future generations? So kind of expanding our vision to where is the border of our relationship, but also what is our responsibility and levels of care with non-human species, individual animals and ecosystems? Where does our responsibility begins or ends in a given situation? Again, expanding our worldview of where does our responsibility should begin or end. Therefore, the Earth Charter can be used as a tool for critical reflection and for responsible action, for inspiring responsible action. So I wanted to talk a little bit more about this notion of dialogue. Dialogue as a pedagogical instrument for transformative learning. Much of our learning emerges through dialogue and sharing of experiences. Promoting dialogue on values and principles that guide or should guide our decisions is crucial to help us better understand our ethical dilemmas, to help us have a vision of our common goals and shared values. This is basic. These are basic ingredients for a strong and healthy community. The Earth Charter is a valuable, or could be seen as a valuable resource for promoting this sort of dialogue to help us identify humanity shared values. But for this kind of dialogue to take place, it requires time, careful listening, respect for cultural diversity and the opinions of others, and the open-minded search for common good. Now, time and careful listening is something that is missing quite a lot from our day-to-day life. But through dialogue, we can connect. So we have been working on emphasizing this notion of intergenerational, intercultural, and multi-sectoral dialogue. Now, in terms of power of vision, what could be the difference of a vision and a shared vision of humanity and the power of that? What could be the power of envisioning the future? And if we do so, through which lenses do we envision the future? Through the lenses of someone from the South, from the North, from the wealthy nations, or for the underprivileged one? We could have different lenses to see the future. What could be the power of having a shared vision of our common future as an educational tool, as a pedagogical tool? A shared vision of common good that supersedes cultural differences and self-interest, as well as the direction for realizing that is crucial. However, it takes time to shape a shared vision. It takes time, it takes a lot of dialogue and sharing. But it also takes persistence and requires persistence and coherence over the years to implement it. And I say this from the perspective that many of us probably have experienced being in a family or in a working environment where various stakeholders have different views of the future of the organization. Future of the organization they belong to. And therefore pull the direction, pull the future of the organization towards different directions. So can you imagine an educational institution, such as a school, where some staff want to take the institution to one direction and other groups to a completely different direction? It doesn't move anywhere because the energy gets fragmented and diluted, and it is hard to make any major work emerge. Therefore, shared values and vision create a sense of closeness and a sense of community. And it helps us to inspire and guide towards action. As I mentioned, much of it depends through which lenses do we see our future. And therefore, a dialogue is there to help us come closer. The last point has to do with collaboration. So for any great work to take place, collaboration is necessary. We all know that. The paradigm shift of sustainability is not an exception. It represents a huge challenge that can only be addressed through collaboration. So effective collaboration regards also common goals, shared values, and that means global ethics. Therefore, the educational challenge here is to provide learners with skills and opportunities for cooperative action and the capacity to collaborate. So I'm sharing these three dimensions or three elements or ingredients as pedagogical elements in education to work with dialogue, shared vision, building a shared vision or envisioning the future, and collaboration as tools for pedagogy. So that once we find ourselves being a small institution, a school, or any sort of institution, when we have different views about where we should go, through dialogue, we could find that common point and common vision of where the direction that the boat should be heading. Now, one last point on values-based education. Values-based education is a contested field. It's very hard when we come to talk about universal or global values. It's a contested field due to concerns over which values and whose values are we promoting? Such concerns are less of an issue when the values being examined represent core values that respect humanity, are life-affirming, and are consistent with those of many cultures around the world. Values-based education requires that those involved in the learning process remain aware of the need to avoid preaching, imposing values, ensuring that the right of individuals to hold or reject values is respected. It's also important to understand that within the search for common good, respect for cultural diversity is a central value. Their charter reminds us that life often involves tensions between important values. This can mean difficult choices. We must find ways to harmonize diversity with unity, the exercise of freedom with the common good. And in any case, critical thinking is needed concerning what values should be guided, or should guide our decisions. What are these values that should guide our decisions and action? And more space could or should be given for reflection on what are the drivers, of our daily decisions. So these are the kinds of questions that we have been addressing as part of our work over the past 10 years in our education center that is located at the University for Peace in Costa Rica, on the campus of the University for Peace. And we have been working with education for sustainability, but mostly at that intersection of ethics, education, and this concept of values of sustainability. I would like to close by sharing the living experience of a school in Costa Rica that I have had the pleasure of working with them for over almost 20 years. It's called Seuna. It's a small school in Costa Rica, primary and secondary school, that I first came across in 1996. And I think by sharing their story is a way for me to pay tribute to the great work that they have been doing. Because over the past 20 years, they have managed to infuse sustainability values throughout their operations, pedagogy, and content of curriculum. And they have been improving that quite a lot. Over the past 20 years, so it takes time, they have demonstrated consistency and perseverance in the work they have been doing. But I think much of their success is due to their capacity to promote dialogue within their institution, capacity to develop shared vision of their values and the direction they want to take, and values that are clearly reflected on their daily work, which makes it quite coherent with what they are trying to do. So this is where we are, located in Costa Rica, and working pretty much in this intersection of sustainability and values and how to bring that into education through the lenses of transformative learning. Thank you very much. I hope I was on time, and thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Wow. Yes, Miriam has offered us a compass, the Earth Charter. So if you don't know what to do or where to go, you have a document to consult, the Earth Charter. And she has offered us three tools that we can use as we educate for sustainability: dialogue, shared vision and values, and collaboration. And she's given us an example of an institution where that has been mainstreamed and it's working. I'd like to come back to you right now. Does anybody have a comment or a question, you know, on what you've just heard. Let's just take one, then I'll go to the next speaker. You want to speak to what you've just heard and share with everyone? Yes, Mr. Katake.
The concept of shared value and what Mirian said at the end, which is cultural diversity being key to this whole thing, we must understand that that shared vision allows differences to happen. Shared vision does not mean that we both agree on what that is, but we both agree that there we will both be able to disagree without fighting. So I think we must understand that the shared vision is not narrowing, but it is broadening. It envisages a world where different people can live differently, not necessarily with a shared vision narrowly defined, but a vision in which we can be pluralistic, we can be diverse, and yet work together and enjoy that diversity as a planet. And I thought that needs to be that discussion on what is a shared value and what is diversity is sometimes can be seen as contradictory.
Yes, but we can take this on later, but shared, can't we have a shared vision around a common future? The fact that we want a future that is environmentally safe?
Yes.
That is the same vision for everybody, isn't it?
We want a shared vision. We want a shared vision, but that shared vision we want where diversity is possible. Sometimes people use the word shared vision to cut down diversity. And I think that's the warning, that the way Mirian is meaning shared vision is consistent with that world which you just described, but which also has diversity in it.
Okay, Mirian, do you want to speak to that?
Thank you for sharing that. Certainly, we should have room for interpretation, room for adaptation. I like to use the metaphor of music and the various ways in which one music could be played, depending on the musician and the capacity of the musician to offer its own heart, soul, and emotion to enrich the music. So, yes, the Urshada does stress the importance of cultural diversity. And actually even that tension between freedom and the way in which we need to share spaces with someone who might be completely different from us. So there is sometimes this dilemma between unity and diversity, but I don't think they should be seen as contradictory. Actually, they are quite complementary. And that's the vision that the Urshada certainly articulates, affirming cultural diversity at the same time as this very important notion of Earth community with our own cultural diversity.
Yes, the discussion continues. Thank you, Mirian. Yeah, as we move on to the next presentation that you're going to listen to, just to remind us that, you know, human threats, you know, have been so severe in the last few decades. And thousands of species and variety are becoming extinct annually. In 1992, the Convention for Biodiversity stressed the fact that conservation of biodiversity for sustainable development and the preservation and perpetuation of life on Earth is so critical at this time. And the question is, can people and planet develop together? Can we develop together? Looking around, looking at what is happening today. And to answer this question is Mirian Krasny, one of the WEEC's 15 winners of Who Wants to Be a Keynote at WEEC 15, a bold woman. She's going to take us on a trip to the world of possibility, a world where people and planet develop together. So please welcome with me Professor Krasny, Director of the Civil Ecology Lab at Cornell University, US of A, United States of America. Yeah.
Well, thank you. I don't know that I've ever received such an enthusiastic introduction. And I want to thank Mirian also for presenting the big picture. I'm going to present sort of a bit of a smaller picture of examples. And I want to thank the audience and the organizing committee, but especially all of those who liked me on Facebook when I did my audition for winning this contest for the WEEC 15 plenary session. So thank you. The Nigerian novelist Chimamanda Adichie warns us about the dangers of single stories. Single stories are stories that we grow up with. In Adichie's middle-class Nigerian family, her mother told her stories about their poor houseboy and his impoverished life. And her mother's stories blinded Adichie to seeing, to appreciating the richness of her houseboy's life, which she only learned about later when she was able to visit his family and his village. And when Adichie moved to the United States to go to the university, she encountered a roommate who had a single story about Africa. Her roommate's single story was about Africa as a single country, not even a continent. She didn't realize it was a continent. It was a single country that was desperately poor, ridden by AIDS, and where lions were roaming around everywhere. So I would ask you today, as environmental educators, are we too bound by single stories, by preconceived notions of cities versus wilderness, of humans versus nature, and of people developing separately from our planet? Are we bound by single stories that limit our ability to appreciate the complexities and the richness of our interrelationships with each other and with the rest of nature? So I'm going to explore these questions today by telling you a few brief stories. And I'm going to start out with what I'll call my wilderness single story. So right after I graduated from college, I had a wonderful opportunity to have a job as a mountaineering instructor in the Glacier Peak Wilderness area, which is in Washington State. And I would guide people on month-long mountaineering expeditions. So one of the things that we did, as you can see in this slide, is that we rappelled down into crevasses where we could see these stunning ice formations. We also summited glacier-clad peaks, the volcanic peaks of the Pacific Northwest in the U.S. But perhaps my most memorable experience was when we were down in the lowlands in the old-growth rainforest of the Pacific Northwest. And in my tent, I would awake every morning to the song of the Swainson's thrush, its trill that would reverberate eerily through the old-growth rainforest. So I love this wilderness experience, but I realized later that it also created in me this wilderness mindset, this wilderness single story. And in the wilderness single story, people are intruders on the planet. We are outsiders, and our only impact is to destroy nature. So when I moved to New York, I carried the single story of people as blight on the landscape. Now, a lot of people have a single story about New York. When I tell them I'm from New York, they think I'm from New York City. But actually, I live in upstate New York, about 5 hours from New York City in the Finger Lakes region of New York. And for anybody that's visited me in the Finger Lakes in upstate New York, they invariably talk about how beautiful the landscape is. We have a number of long, narrow lakes, like this one. We have numerous waterfalls, and our landscape is really a rural landscape, dotted by forest, farmland, and vineyards. But I could only see, I was blinded by my wilderness single story, and all I saw was something different, not the beauty of the landscape, but instead the trailer parks, the rundown houses, and the junkyards that pockmarked that landscape. So to me, it was not possible for the planet and people to develop together. So fast forward 20 years, and I had another very different, what I'll call my third or different nature experience. And this time, it was in a community garden in New York City, the Open Road Community Garden, shown here in this slide. And in that garden, there were children who were tending this greenhouse. They had a compost pile. They were raising seedlings to outplant into this community garden. But if you can imagine, if you looked on the opposite side of the garden, away from this greenhouse, there was something very different going on. There was a raised bed system, and it was tended by Bangladeshi immigrants who were from a nearby mosque. And this is in Manhattan. These Bangladeshi immigrants were wearing these long shirts called kurtas. And they had created in this raised bed system what I can only suppose was a replica of an intercropping system that they had planted in Bangladesh. So they had in this raised bed system in New York City, they had pigeon peas, a legume, amaranth, a grain. They were raising marigold in these raised beds to repel soil nematodes, and also flowering coriander as a way to attract beneficial insects. Now, what was this community garden had previously been a vacant lot, but not just any vacant lot. It had been a parking lot, a bus parking lot that was contaminated by diesel fuel. So what the children and these Bangladeshi immigrants had done is they had converted this, what I'll call a broken place, into a space where the children could listen to the story of the elders, the immigrants, and the elders could listen to the stories of the children. So what does the story of children and elders, immigrants in New York City tell us? Well, many of my colleagues and myself, when I was blinded perhaps by the single story of wilderness single story, might call this community garden story a story of extinction of experience. And the lepidopterist Robert Pyle first talked about the extinction of experience in 1975. And he wrote, read a quote, "As cities and metastasizing suburbs forsake their natural diversity and their citizens grow more removed from personal contact with nature, awareness and appreciation retreat. This breeds apathy towards environmental concerns and, inevitably, further degradation of the common habitat." And so it goes on and on. The extinction of experience, sucking the life from the land, the intimacy from our connections. People who don't know don't care. What is the extinction of the condor to a child who has never known a wren? The children in New York City community gardens might never hear the song of a wren. And this is a loss, and I don't think we can deny it. But is their story a single story of extinction of experience? Or is their story perhaps a rich story of people intimately intertwined with each other and nature in cities, the places where most of our planet's citizens live and experience nature? Is this possibly a rich story of people and our planet developing together? Well, perhaps just as stereotypes are difficult to get rid of, I'll probably never totally abandon my wilderness mindset or my wilderness single story. I still long often to hear the sound, to hear the song of the Swainson's thrush reverberating through the old-growth forest. But for most of the world, stories about nature are being formed in cities. So what are some of these stories? Well, some of these stories are formed by a group in India called the Ugly Indian. And the Ugly Indian realizes that much of the world looks like this. They also realize that we are all Ugly Indians, that we are all responsible. And their motto is a sort of a riff on Gandhi's model that we heard about yesterday from Provost Holmberg from Chalmers University. Gandhi, who has been quoted to say, "Be the change you want to see." So they've switched this around and they talk about seeing the change we want to be. So they carry out this motto of seeing the change we want to be by conducting what they call spot fixes. And those are short-term collective actions where volunteers, people on the street come out, and they convert sites that look like this to this. So this last spring, I had the opportunity to teach a massive open online course, or a MOOC, on the edX platform. And the name of my MOOC was Reclaiming Broken Places, Introduction to Civic Ecology. And civic ecology is the practice and the theory around people restoring and stewarding vacant and trashed out lots, like the one you just saw in India or the one that I talked about in New York, and other degraded places and cities, and after disaster and conflict. And there's always not only an environmental component of these practices, but also a community or a social component. So I'm gonna just share with you photos of some of the projects, Reclaiming Broken Places or civic ecology projects, that the people in our MOOC shared with us, either over Facebook or by a blog platform called Storify. And as I show you quickly these photographs, I hope that you'll imagine the stories behind them, because I'm going to come back to that at the end. So one of the stories was from Ukraine, and it was about one of the first community gardens in Kiev. And remember that this was going on, this class was occurring in April and March of this year, so it was a time of a lot of unrest, in Ukraine. We had a lot of stories of mangrove restoration, some from Tanzania, this one from the Philippines. People are planting mangrove seedlings in an attempt to protect their coastal shoreline and restore fisheries habitat. We had tree planting stories, this one from Botswana, which is actually a project of the South African Development, or Southern African Development Community, Regional Environmental Education Program, which is represented here. And we had a number of students from Syria, and they talked about an agriculture environmental training project for young people in an institution for the young people with mental illness. And we had a story from Brazil where volunteers converted a vacant lot to a pocket park. And then finally, we had this very moving story from Japan. This is a story of an earthquake which called a massive landslide, devastating, killed over 30 people. And you can see that the volunteers here have, they've created a beautiful flower garden on the site of that landscape, and the site of that landslide. So each one of these projects, the spot fixes in India, the community gardens in Ukraine and the US, the mangrove restoration in the Philippines, the tree planting in Botswana, the agriculture and environmental training project in Syria, the pocket park in Brazil, and the beautiful garden on a landscape in Japan, are stories of people reclaiming broken places. But more broadly, they're stories about people and nature. So what do these stories tell us? Are these single stories of extinction of experience? Because there's no wilderness, because people are experiencing nature in disturbed, even contaminated environments? Or could they be something else, different from wilderness experiences of the past, but nevertheless rich experiences? Well, I would contend that these are not single stories of extinction of experience. Rather, today's stories are complex and rich stories of people reclaiming broken places. They are stories of people creating new ways to experience, and perhaps more importantly, to care for nature and each other, or nature and community. I would contend that these are rich stories of people and our planet developing together. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank
you. Well, thank you, Mariam. I think we need to be reminded often and often again of the danger of the single story of of destruction, environmental degradation, ISIS, you know, so on. So, I mean, thank you so much, Mariam, for reminding us to make room for these thousands and hundreds of good stories of the healing of the earth, of men and women, you know, working hard. You know, that's so great. And I'm sure that maybe some of us would have some comments or some stories to tell or some questions. Please, it's your turn. Can we hear some of your stories, questions, or some comments to these great speakers that we've had today? Can I have some stories, some questions, some comments? I have room for just one, I think, or two. Okay, yes, is there one behind? Okay, yes, please, sir. Then is there any other? Then I'll take, okay, you, yes, I see your hand. And that's all, yeah, great. So let's have you first.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, I see.
Hello?
Hello?
I just have...
Yes?
Oh, there are two people. We have him first, then you second, please. Thank you, sister. Right. Oh, he wants to be a gentleman. So ladies first. Come on. Let's have you then.
Thank you. Thank you, brother. I just have a practical question. We talk about all these concepts or these pedagogical, sorry for the... ways of doing and sharing and collaborating, but it is quite difficult to find the unity and in a diversity or in a plurality, right? So you have a lot of experience, and I would like to hear a bit more practical. Maybe tips to achieve this dialogue. When you talk about it, what do you really mean in practical ways? How can we use it in more practical ways and not so theoretical?
Okay, I'll take the second question before I hand over to them. Yes, let's have. So, but if you could just
thank
ask
you.
30
it is rather a comment
you could invite them for discussions after.
Than a question. And I see a communality between the two presentations. In fact, we are talking about educating to see the reality, which actually comes with different ways, different images at the same time. And in fact, when we are talking about shared visions, first of all, we may be part of different shared visions of different groups. I come from Greece, and today we may destroy our country because we have shared visions, one for democracy and the other for Europe, but not seeing the two necessarily together. And at this very moment, you have a shared vision built in years and years. And many of us actually share both. Most of us share both. But when you have to make the choice at a given moment under pressure, then you jump to one of your visions, shared visions, both. The same is with areas around us. We have to live with both. We have to teach people not to lose hope even without reclaiming this land. We have to reclaim it. Congratulations. But we cannot live by hoping to reclaim all the land. And this is very important. This is the main teaching is that we have to live in a world which is a mosaic. So we have to have the plan for this mosaic. If this can be a vision, yes. Because otherwise, I have problems. I have problems as a teacher because the realities around me actually will push me to the corner with the first criticism of the children finding out that even some of our shared visions are not valid. And this is very important.
Okay. Thank you, thank you. Yes, so just 30 second response each. Yes, we'll start with you, Mirian.
Okay, very briefly, and I would be very happy to further discuss about this with you. But given the time we have, I would like to use the metaphor of cooking or baking a carrot cake. There are different ways in which we could bake a carrot cake, different ingredients, but it will always be, at some point, a carrot cake with sometimes different tastes. So you asked, the lady asked about like examples and the why in terms of unity and diversity. I think it's like, if you have a different ways of baking your carrot cake and mine, but if we want to join forces in cooking one, we are going to have to do dialogue, right? And share our different experience in baking carrot cake. And probably the flavor, and if we decide to do this together, our carrot cake, and join our two recipes, we'll probably have a different taste than mine or yours. But it will be a joint carrot cake bringing together our knowledge, right? But still, at the end of it, it will be a carrot cake. Yeah. So I'm just using one metaphor of through a dialogue of sharing our different lenses and perspectives of how we should go about the cooking of that cake, through that sharing of information and experience in that dialogue, it's that a lot of learning emerges and new possibilities too. But the point is that we don't sit together to share, and we make assumptions that there are completely different ways of doing things. So, sorry. Right.
Thank you. And Maria?
I think a lot of the questions have to do with diversity, and I guess what I want to say is that the kinds of practices I talked about today are a bit intuitive. We don't always expect cities, people in cities or people after disasters or even in conflict zones to turn to nature and community and try to restore and steward both of these. But wherever I go and through my MOOC, I find these all over the world. So in a sense, they have a commonality, but they're also very diverse the way people are sort of turning to nature in these difficult times and situations. I think it's a very important thing for us to look at because of this issue of hope that you talked about. And they are positive stories that can also scale up, which we could talk about offline. When we had more time. I think they scale up to contribute to efforts like the Earth Charter.
Yes, and I'm happy that this session flows into the next one. The next one is about action, the Global Action Program for ESD. So it's about practical, you know, things. What can we do? What action should we be taking? So we would have more answers to the questions that have been fielded here. So to conclude, you know, this session, I'd like to say that what we have had today is about a future that is possible. It is about the many stories which sound education premised on the sustainability dream bring to the table, even as the global community contemplate the new strategic development goals for post-2015. So the key message I'm taking home from Mirian here is that let's continue to dialogue. You know, because the more we can work together, you know, collaborate, you know, towards this future that we want for our children. And from Mirian here, you know, she reminded us of the Chimamanda Adichie's story, The Danger of a Single Story. And what I get from her presentation is that there is hope in the air when we learn to see the change we want to be. You know, not just to see the horrible things happening. Let's learn to see the change that is happening. The change is there. It's happening. Let's see it. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much. And thank you. Help me to applaud my
thank
team.
You.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Am I on? Good people of the auditorium. Thank you for quieting down a little bit and listening to me while our panelists is gathering here up on stage. Since we have run over a little bit, so I would ask all of you who are leaving the session to keep your talking to the minimum, because I want to do two announcements. The first announcement is that the RCE GAP side event 1815 is moved to room C444 at Humanisten. So the side event after this one, RCE GAP at 1815, is moved to room C444 at Humanisten. Then I would like to ask if there are any Danish people in the auditorium. Any Danes? Not a single Dane. So, any people from Zimbabwe? Yes? There? Yes, of course. Anyone from Finland? Okay, cool. Kippis. And what about Australia? Any Aussies here? Hey, you guys should meet under the WEEC banner in the stairs afterwards. The Aussies, right? The Finns and the Zimbabweans, and the Swedes, we will take care of ourselves. But the Aussies, they will meet there. And it's Cam who says this to you. I'll go ahead and just say a big welcome to you all, brave people, coming to this last plenary session. My name is David. I'll be your moderator today. I'm research leader at SWEDESD, an international center under the Faculty of Education at Uppsala University. The organizers of this plenary session is the Ministry of the Environment and Energy, SIDA, Swedish National Commission for UNESCO, Swedish Society for Nature Conservation, SWEDESD, WWF Sweden, and the Swedish Council for Higher Education. So each speaker will be given 6 to 7 minutes. I will be very strict and harsh. Not very strict, but somewhat strict. Try to be. So we keep the time with the help of Rebecca there. After the panelists have finished, I will open the floor first if they want to ask each other some questions, and then for the auditorium. When we approached the panelists, we had three questions in mind. How do we integrate issues regarding educational quality in our upscaling gap activities? How do we choose which ESD activities to scale up? And how should we take context into consideration as we implement the gap? So what we are basically talking about now is that we've been piloting for 10 years, right? Is that the message? And now we're going to make some real business out of this, make things happen. So what can we do? This is basically the issue that we have asked our panelists, who from the left are Alexander Leicht, Chief Section of Education for Sustainable Development, UNESCO Paris, Sinaida Fadeva, Doctor and Senior Specialist for the ESD Program, United Nations University Institute for the Advanced Study of Sustainability, Sylvia Utete, Permanent Secretary, Ministry of Primary and Secondary Education, Zimbabwe, Uranchi Meg Tserendori, Senior Officer, Ministry of Environment, Green Development and Tourism of Mongolia, and Lisa Emilia Svensson, Doctor and Ambassador for Ocean and Seas in Sweden. Let's give these guys a big hand. So please, Alexander. You can sit here.
Okay, great. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, David. Thank you very much for the introduction. I'll just give you maybe in a very few minutes just the very basics with regard to the Global Action Program on Education for Sustainable Development. The genesis of the GAP is very simple. When at the end of the United Nations decade of Education for Sustainable Development, the global community in ESD assessed what has been done. They concluded that an incredible amount of good practice has happened during the United Nations decade, and we as UNESCO put together all of this good practice in the final report on the decade that you may have seen or can find on our website. But at the same time, the community of ESD concluded that a lot of work needs to be done still to systematically integrate sustainable learning, education for sustainable development, and all related agendas into education and into sustainable development. So UNESCO member states, all of UNESCO member states came together in a process that we organized together with a number of non-governmental stakeholders, individual practitioners, young people, local authorities, and many other stakeholders, and discussed and consulted what should we do as the next step after the United Nations decade of ESD. The conclusion was we should have a very focused, very targeted program that initially runs for 5 years and that emphasizes generating and scaling up action on ESD, moving beyond pilot projects, moving beyond ESD projects that depend very much on individuals and on committed individuals, and moving towards an upscaling that also means systematically integrating ESD into education and into sustainable development. So very simply, the Global Action Program is a joint strategy of the global ESD community for the next 5 years initially, and then probably longer into the future after an assessment of the first 5 years. It's a commitment from many stakeholders to do action on the ground in education for sustainable development and in related fields. And it is very importantly, and that is worth stressing, a commitment from member states. The Global Action Program has gone through the formal UNESCO process, has gone through the formal process of the UNESCO governing bodies, and that means that every member state of UNESCO, every one of the 195 member states, committed to the strategy, committed to generating action in ESD under the Global Action Program. So there's this very strong political mandate that comes with the Global Action Program. In the meantime, also, the Global Action Program was not only endorsed by UNESCO, by the UNESCO governing bodies, but the United Nations General Assembly at the end of last year also acknowledged the Global Action Program as a follow-up to the United Nations decade of ESD. The overall goal, I've mentioned it, is to generate and scale up action in education for sustainable development. And that means, on the one hand, addressing the education community and ensuring that education, as we understand it today, properly prepares learners for sustainable development. We all know that the way education is practiced across the world, very often that is not the case yet. And the second objective is geared towards the wider sustainable development community, and tries to convince and mobilize the wider sustainable development community to use education as an implementation mechanism, as a means of implementation for their goals and objectives. We have identified, together with our member states and a wider group of stakeholders, 5 areas where action should be generated. You can see them listed on the slide. The first one is policy, ensuring that we have the right kind of policy environment for education for sustainable development, working with policymakers, and it's great to see a number of them on the panel here. The second one is looking at institutions, in particular education institutions, and ensure that they address education for sustainable development in a holistic way, that they do not only teach one or the other sustainable development topic, but that they properly approach sustainable development in a holistic fashion, which includes, for example, in universities, the campus and facilities management, to just mention one aspect. The third area is educators and empowering them to be learning facilitators for ESD. The fourth area is empowering youth as change agents for sustainable development, empowering youth through education for sustainable development. And the fifth area is to look at the local level and to look at the different stakeholders and multi-stakeholder processes that take place at the local level, and how can they empower it for sustainable development through education. These are the five areas where we hope that over the next 5 years, a large amount of practice, a large amount of solid and large-scale work will happen. We as UNESCO, try to, at the global level, provide a platform for this process and also drive this process. We have a very specific mechanism put in place for that. We are working systematically with a number of key partner organizations around these five priority action areas, as we call them, policy institutions, etc., through to local communities. At the policy level, for example, we have developed partnerships with a number of ministries of education across the world that are committed to driving this area forward together with us. We're also very committed to showcasing the good practice that is taking place in ESD across the world, and for that we have launched a big UNESCO prize on education for sustainable development that will be awarded for the first time this year. And we hope that these strategies, showcasing good practice and in particular working through partnerships, will also be implemented at the national level and not only by us at the international level. And I close with reminding you and all of ourselves that when we look at the national level, it's important to see that really all governments across the world have made a commitment to undertake work under the Global Action Program, and so we hope that in every country as well we have supporting mechanisms in place for that. So that's my brief summary of the basics, and I'm very happy to discuss further with you in the exchange. Thanks.
Thank you, Alexander. We'll do it like this, that we save the questions for after all the panelists have made their statements. So we'll move on to Zenaida, please.
Thank you. Have you ever tried to paint a portrait of somebody? Well, it's pretty difficult unless you are very talented, but if you are to paint a portrait of a movement which consists of 138, as of today, networks, you really have to be a genius, and I'm definitely not. So what I will do, I will refer to some of the colors offered by the panelists before and previous sessions of this conference, as well as by the work which is done by the community of regional centers of expertise on education for sustainable development, so, and publication by this community with United Nations University I'm holding in my hands now. So one of the interesting questions which offered or which sound as a refrain throughout this conference is a avoidance of monotone or monopicture or one single picture. And what we can say, talking about regional centers of expertise, which are networks of formal and non-formal organizations of learnings in the regions, in the localities, is they are definitely not about something monotone, because these organizations come together to address through learning practices and innovations sustainability programs, problems of their own respective regions now. And as a proof of it, let me just quickly read to you some of the metaphors by which RCEs, Regional Centers of Expertise on ESD, themselves describe. So the list is, in fact, quite long. I will limit myself to some 5 to 10 of the metaphors. Our RCE is a network of creative forces. This is from RCE's corner in Sweden. A rich resource pool being tapped for common goals. RCE Delhi in India says that. An umbrella towards change. That is the words of the RCE Tongyong in South Korea. Possibly best described by an African proverb, if one wants to go quickly, one goes alone. If one wants to go far, one goes unaccompanied. This is from RC Porto, metropolitan area in Portugal. Like a busy bee yard, from RC in Nuremberg. The spring field that has various kinds of sprout and young leaves and flowers everywhere. It's from RC Okayama, and the list and metaphors go on and on. So, the interesting characteristics of the RCEs is that as I mentioned, they bring representative of educational community, formal and informal, as well as those which are working with issues of sustainable development. And as this network exists and flourishes and struggles also for more than 10 years, naturally certain very interesting processes of self-mobilization and engagement with other communities of practices are occurring. Quite a few RCEs are sitting in this room, and this is one example how RCEs are participating in learning communities. In October in Paris, summer seas would come to contribute to the climate COP. Later on in the year, they would be working with CBD, Convention on Biological Diversity meetings, to contribute to the issues of ecosystem services and biodiversity. Also in the autumn, we will have their participation during the resource panel in Davos. And the list goes on year after year. So it is exactly this bringing together of the partners from educational or non-educational sectors enables the RCEs to experiment and innovate and work and mobilize locally, as well as link to the global sustainability processes, providing from one hand interesting test bed from the global processes and policies, on the other hand learning and engaging at the local level. So that's an interesting contribution, and really the practical way to realize the major ambition of the GAP, isn't it? To bring education into sustainability processes and sustainability processes back into the education. It is experimented with by the RC community. Another point which I wanted to make here is that, again, comes from the publication which is in this particular case written by the RCEs themselves, and let me just read it for you. As an initiative of UNU, the representatives of the RC community writing, RCEs are themselves, in part, as a global scholarly network with a central goal of research and innovation related to ESD, as a global scholarly network, RCEs need to structurally resist being categorized in such a way that hampers their curiosity and freedom to investigate the most promising educational solutions to sustainable development challenges, whether or not they fall within the priority research and action areas of specific organizations. The participation of RCE with higher education partners presupposes that conditions of academic freedom need to be maintained by RCE as part of this initiative. So in other words, association with RCEs and UN system as a whole very often being given the RCE's legitimacy, we hear from the RCE partners, to act as an independent and really sustainability and local goal-driven network of scholars and experimenters. And final point about the contribution to specific priority of gaps, which was an interesting discussion prior to the conference in November through a series of consultations within the continental communities of the RCEs. And in parenthesis, let me just share with you that this network, this movement, is largely self-driven. So we attempt to mobilize and facilitate our partners and work with them, but a lot of efforts, probably up to 80-90, go through self-mobilization and local, national, subcontinental, and continental meetings are going on. So this is what have come, and I will read one short paragraph for you from the discussion, how RCE community can contribute to GAP, with a single idea that while RCEs do contribute to individual priorities, real force of this community is to keep five priorities in coherent whole. So, a couple of examples how they envisioned several blending priorities can look like in the performance of the RCEs. A practical example of such a program would integrate three of the GAP priorities: whole institution approach, improve qualification of educators and youth, It is in this case, universities of applied sciences could be encouraged to support TVET, technical vocational education and training colleges, at the secondary level. Cooperation of classical universities with universities of applied sciences could facilitate their research components. And finally, appropriate evaluation system and counting prior learning by giving relevant credits would facilitate an educational continuum that provides innovative models for lifelong learning. This is just one model. Which was proposed as a collective undertaking of the RCE community along three, in this case, priority areas.
Thank you,
now, let me just finish by pointing at the slide in case you're wondering what it is. This is an ambition of the United Nations University to support the RCE community as well as other communities with which we are working, not only towards the gap, realization of gap ambition, but also bringing, with our colleagues from UNESCO and other UN institutions and international agency, bringing gap and educational ambitions with other sustainability global movements. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Please.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon. Thank you. At least we are together. My topic is on implementing the Global Action Plan and the case of Southern Africa. I have taken Zimbabwe as a test case in terms of what we have started doing in trying to position ourselves for the implementation of the Global Action Program. The overall goal of the Global Action Program, GAP, is to generate and scale up action at all levels and areas of education and learning, and to accelerate progress towards sustainable development as enshrined in the five priority action areas that were highlighted there. Notably, the commitment that many African education ministries are making to integrate environment and sustainable development issues such as health, poverty alleviation, and indigenous knowledge in national curricula is highly commendable. Zimbabwe joined the rest of the Southern African Development Community, SADC, in the adoption of education for sustainable development as a national policy. Further, the Zimbabwe Ministry of Primary and Secondary Education embarked on a consultative curriculum review process and developed a curriculum blueprint, which we call 2015 to 2022, underpinned by five key pillars. And these pillars talk to the five action areas. The pillars are, one, the regulatory framework, which is the policy that we are talking about there, ensuring policy reviews are harmonized with the provisions of the 2013 new constitution and other national policies. Teacher capacity development, enhancing teacher qualification in critical areas in readiness for curriculum implementation. Five universities are actually working with the ministry and they are heavily involved. Teacher professional standards. The other problem that we have is the teacher education area is not professionalized. You find in other countries, yes, but really we are saying it is important that the teaching profession is professionalized in the same manner that we have the legal fraternity, we have the health fraternity or the medical fraternity. So establishing a teachers council aimed at professionalizing the profession. And we are also in the process of introducing peer support systems where those good headmasters, heads of schools can actually help others in terms of developing. And the fourth one is infrastructure development. If we don't have proper infrastructure in our school system, we can be groping in the dark. So we are looking at this as well, and we are also looking at establishing the Center for Education, Innovation and Research. And what are the principles or the values that underpin this curriculum? Inclusivity. Inclusivity not just in case of ensuring that those that are physically challenged are included. We are also looking at out-of-school youths. We are also looking at those that are not able to pay fees because of one reason or another. Accessibility, equity, relevance, and quality, because this is important. Continuity, we are looking at lifelong learning, and we are also looking at second chance education. Respect, the curriculum is underpinned by a philosophy, and the philosophy is Wunu in our language, Ubuntu. You are because I am because you are. You are because I am. That's what it means. So there is that value system, communication, diversity, transparency. And what are the competencies that we expect coming out of this curriculum? Critical thinking, problem solving, leadership, communication, and technological. And we have actually tried to now have the curriculum divided in such a manner that we have infant education. Infant education is starting from preschool, early childhood development. Then we go to junior, we go to secondary. And they are cross-cutting themes. And these cross-cutting themes are environment, health education, heritage studies, and enterprise development. And lastly, we are also looking at the assessment. How do you assess this curriculum? How do you assess the learners? And we are looking at profiling the child as they start from preschool right up. You have a profile in terms of the talents that this child has, in terms of the attributes that this child has. We are also looking at continuous assessment that will then capture all the learning capabilities from that level. And then we are also looking at some component of summative assessment. And there is also built into this what we call skills, lifelong learning skills. And to just finish off, I have just a clip, a small video clip, to show how this is married to what I have just said, and in terms of also how we are involving communities at this preparatory stage. So if I can just quickly have that clip.
The lake can only hold a certain amount of water, but these areas here store water like great big underground lakes. So if you hold up the soil and see how much water drips out of it when it's wet, you'll see one drop, one drop, one drop, one drop. So that's exactly what this wetland is. It's like a sponge.
There are very specific conditions for how to treat wetlands. There should be a review on how physical planning works. It seems to work in isolation. They see a piece of land that's empty, they draw rectangles on it and say this is now a housing or a shopping mall, without checking what environmental consequences of that kind of development would be.
In the wetlands, you find different types of flowers, different creatures, and so many soggy puddles.
We've never seen a wetland before, so we got the chance to see it today.
There are 27 wetlands in Harare.
Women in rural areas are learning to manage their livestock more effectively in order to increase crop yields and manage grazing land for their livestock in the fight against poverty and hunger.
the animal impacting program creates extremely fertile fields for those rural communities using its principles, which in turn constitutes significant savings, mainly for rural women, in terms of fertilizer costs and also savings in terms of protecting the environment from often harmful chemicals. This land, for example, is land that had been ravaged by overgrazing livestock. Gullies have formed and the soil is slowly dying. On the other hand, this land was animal impacted 2 years ago. In two short years, the grass has grown back and the new trees are now taking root. With proper management of these pieces of land, food will be plentiful for all. Panon Seed Company supplied maize seed to some of the beneficiaries of the Holistic Management Approach training program. Mr. and Mrs. Murira are among them. And through the success of the holistic management demonstration on his field, Agritex decided to hold a field day celebration at the Murira homestead.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sylvia. And now we will hear from our Mongolian representative, Ranchimeg Tserendori. Please.
Thank you very much. It is my pleasure to convey the wishes, appreciation, and the success, the conference from the Ministry of Environment, Green Development, and Tourism, and from Ministry of Education, Culture, and Science, the key government agency dealing with education for sustainable development in Mongolia. Next slide, please. Mongolia is the country located at central. Occupying territory 1.5 million square kilometers, bordering with China in the south and Russia in the north. Steppes and the Gobi steppes dominating are both very fragile ecosystems. The population is small, amounting to 3 million, and almost half the population live in urban areas. Traditionally, the country was poorly dependent on pastoral herding. However, with the current economic diversification, mining and natural tourism have been fast-growing and are both contributing and increased the GDP. Natural resources, especially minerals, are the current base for Mongolia's economy. The poor sensitive use of the request for the country's long-term well-being. The government of Mongolia gives priority for sustainable development, trying to find balance between environmental protection and socio-economic development as by the principles of the so-called UNESCO Convention 1922. In recent years, the government of Mongolia has taken a number of significant steps to create a legal framework for the sustainable development. The Parliament of Mongolia has in 2014 adopted a national green development policy as an example. One of the guiding principles of the policy is the strengthening environmentally friendly attitudes and the competition in society. Future the Ministry of Education, Culture and Science is the implementing quality reform integrated education for sustainable development into both informal and formal education. The program states that the Mongolian citizen should be grown up as well educated, highly competitive, creative and practical citizen. In this is the understood that the sustainable of Mongolia is also responsibility of the education sector. The next slide. The education sector has in turn concluded that the ESD contribution to the overall creating sustainable Mongolia and government of Mongolia through full supports in the ESD within above mentioned policy. Future Mongolia powers the approach integrated ESD concepts and the principles into school subject and classes rather than creating a subject matter on its own. Accordingly, the Minister of Education, Cultural and Science integrating ESD into primary and secondary schools curriculum and textbook and teachers' books. The ESD approach is also covering the practical school management, pre- and in-service teachers' training, as well as school inspection. The focus in the education is to influence the values into developed skills to be applied daily life at the home or in the society. As mentioned, the principles of sustainability should not only be replaced in the curriculum, but also in the textbooks, in the teachers' manuals. This reform is ongoing, and over 200 specialists are currently working in the new textbooks and the teachers' manuals for both lower and higher secondary schools. Okay, next slide, please. For ESD in the school should be trusted, sustainable should also apply the construction of school building as well as in operations maintenance. For example, using energy efficient, environmentally friendly construction materials for school building and reuse of water as part of sustainable in education systems. Throughout, the Ministry of Environment is introducing green school building concepts and is now working in preparing green school building guidelines and the design. The two ministries are working cross-sectoral and strengthen our sustainability. In applying the education reform towards ESD Mongolia, face a number of challenges. These are institutional as well as conceptual and covers also knowledge management and the information sharing. Next slide, please. And joined the ESD for all this project under both the Ministry of Environment and Green Development and Tourism and Ministry of Education, Culture and Science, as well as the Swiss Development Corporation has been instituted 2015. In this program, we find clear link to the ESD gap process as shown in the figure on the screen in the picture. This picture shows that the ESD gap aims to integrate sustainable development into education, but also and parallel to integrate education into sustainable development in the society as a whole. This is also in line with current project ESD for all in the similar between gaps in the project, they were very strong. Mongolia is committed to integrate the global principles of sustainable development into national policy and programs for the society as whole and using ESD as way to build foundation increased sustainably. Mongolia is in the middle of an ESD reform for both the schools and the society. We are in a way doing the gap in our country. We invite you to Mongolia to study our progress, but we also want to underline that we need to learn from best practice other countries. Thank you for attention. Share experience, listen, deliver, build strength, sustainable across world. Actually, thinking globally, act locked. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And now for our last panelist, Lisa Amelia Svensson, please.
Thank you. Thank you. I follow my colleague's example and stay right here. Thank you for inviting me to this Swedish panel. I'm representing the Swedish government, though being the ambassador for seas and ocean, which we know is two-thirds of the planet. But one program that I would like to share is how we are implementing this action program. And it's a program on sustainable lifestyle and education. And it's within the 10-year framework on sustainable consumption and production. And as we know, it was adopted of the head of states in Rio plus 20 in a few years ago. And it's a part of the international cooperation, which is a shift towards sustainable consumption and production, both in developing and developed worlds.
And a part of this framework is 6 different programs, and our program is one of them. And it's led by Sweden, and together with WWF and Japan. And it was adopted or launched last year in Nagoya in November at the UNESCO International Conference on Educational for Sustainable Development. And the vision of the program is a world where sustainable lifestyles are desirable, beneficial, and accessible for everyone, enabled and supported and encouraged by all sectors of the society, business, including government, and of course the civil society in itself. And we have 3 different parts which this program consists of. And foremost is about promoting innovative models and practice, developing conclusive policies and infrastructure. And secondly, we are developing scenarios, frameworks, and tools. And thirdly, we are also part of mainstreaming sustainable lifestyle into all formal educational, making sustainable lifestyle a focus in every learning environment, but also mobilizing and empowering youth in sustainable lifestyles. So this is one example how we are working on actually implementing the Global Action Program. And we of course welcome all partners and countries to join us in this effort together with Japan and WWF. But I also wanted to share with you a few experiences that we have from the Swedish side working on sort of education for sustainable development. And clearly, we all have a role in this work, but the role of government is crucial. It's foremost important. We need to have a national action plan, and it needs to be integrated and also have resources. We need to measure what we're doing, but also follow up and monitoring that work on part of the education. And secondly, we also need to bridging this educational effort. We need to bridge it into innovation and what we call green technology and the green development. And also, of course, a part of this in entrepreneurship, educating for finding innovation and creating innovations and entrepreneurs, which is the foundation of an economic growth in a sustainable way. And thirdly, we're also talking about streamlining education in all policy areas, because sustainability is really not an area in itself. It really needs to be integrated in all our government offices. And there's, of course, we know it's a crucial area to work holistically in moving away from those what we call stuprör in Swedish, which I never find a good word in English. And lastly, let me also mention a little bit being the ambassador for ocean. We know that 90% of all life is in ocean. So talking about ocean is really about talking life in itself. And this is also about the educational effort that we need to do, linking what's happening in land and what's the connection with the ocean. And this is one, I think it's a tremendous great example on this issue that we need about education. And I was particularly pleased that we heard also the wetland was mentioned. And also in the earlier panel, we mentioned mangroves. We don't know the importance of those ecosystems, and not only the ecosystem in itself, but also how they are linked into other sort of sustainable activities. And a part of this ocean agenda is also the food security. We know that food security is obviously fish, but we also have aquaculture as a part of feeding 9 billion people. And if we are going to have a sustainable world in the future, we also need to have sustainable livestock and food security. And a lot of people depend on the protein that they got from the ocean. So linking what we know, not only on land, but also how we get this access to food security needs to be addressed in a sustainable way. And I was also particularly pleased to hear those examples from Africa, because this month, SUMA, which is the chair of African Commission, she will launch the Decade of Ocean for Africa. And a part of this is really about the capacity building and educational aspects, for example, the African continent, about why is ocean such, why does it matter for Africa? Because the lack of knowledge, the lack of educational aspects of using those resources and how it can come to Africa is crucial. So that's really behind that. And lastly, I wanted to just show you my slide. Because what we need when we're going to implement the Global Action Program is really all stakeholders. But foremost, all the political engagement needs to reach out with the civil society and obviously the next generation, the youth. We are not in this ourselves. We need all actors to be engaged and also engaging both on the grassroots level, but of course as a top level as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So now we have, we are 10 minutes to six. And since this is the last session and we started late, we will finish soon. No, we might actually go over a couple of minutes, 5 minutes. For those of you who are going to the RC session, just sneak out the door silently. But I will first start with asking you if you have any questions to each other, if what you've talked about today raised questions. So please, if that is the case, you have your opportunity now. You're representing three governments and, you know, different. Please, yes.
I wanted to ask UNESCO how you are foreseeing the implementation follow-up on those action programs that are launched, I think, worldwide. How can you, how will you be able to measure it and how to actually showcase and learning among different programs and sharing that experience?
Thanks very much. That's a crucial question, and as you know, that is a question that has been with us throughout the decade, where we try to monitor what has happened in education for sustainable development, and have encountered a number of challenges with regard to tracking what is happening. The way we want to do it for the Global Action Program is in a very pragmatic way. First of all, we want to see what these key organizations, these key partners that we work with, what they achieve over the first 5 years. They are asked to submit a very concrete commitment to what they want to do under the GAP, and we will, together with these partners, track how this commitment is implemented. So that is one indicator that we use for the progress measurement. And then we are trying to find a number of countries that on a voluntary basis, a sample of countries that on a voluntary basis agrees to set a baseline for the work that they do domestically, and that would agree to provide data throughout the 5 years where we can track the progress of the government action. And that is still ongoing at the moment, that we're trying to find a couple of volunteers among the member states. In addition to that, of course, we are, because you also ask about the learning from each other and the sharing good practices, we're putting in place a website and a clearinghouse website where we hope to make as many good practices as possible available for mutual learning.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay, so let's take questions from the audience then. Please wave, okay? Over there, thanks. I'm gonna stand up, I'm more used to that.
Thank you very much for your brief but informative presentations. We are actually grateful for that. My questions are a kind of just a highlight on what Zeneda Padiva has said about the RCEs, is that there are some umbrellas, or there is an umbrella that is called Global RCE Youth Network. It's a youth network under the Global RCEs that is engaging the youth, as where we all know the priority areas of the GAV is youth is part of that. So Zeneda Fadiba, I want you to briefly tell the audiences how the Global RC Youth Network is trying to put together and complement the GAV, the Global Action Program. That's how the youth network will collaborate with other organizations in the world to implement the GAP. Thank you.
Yes, please, yes.
Thank you, Usman. Usman is one of the leaders of youth which come together globally to mobilize youth chapter of the regional centers of expertise. And they're facing quite a serious and interesting challenge within their own community, not only to rely on the young people which are already switched on towards sustainable development or transformation and learning, but also to engage young people which are not yet engaged. So it's quite serious work going on, and you feel strong enough at this moment at the global level or at the local level to start mobilizing globally, it seems. What Usman knows and probably wants me to say, so it's not me reporting to him, it is actually me channeling from the stage something which is happening within the ERC youth community, is that young people started to ask us, as well as some other organizations which are supporting the RCE community and mentoring it, including us at UNU, is that young people from the RCE started to get engaged in the various processes. One of the latest interesting innovations that some of them, in fact, enrolled themselves as a group in the Sustainable Development Solution Network. It's a huge initiative with leadership of Jeffrey Sachs, as you know. And they are looking at the sustainability courses there with a very critical eye of the young people, seeing to what extent the lectures which are coming from Jeff Sachs and his team and their affiliated institutions actually are facilitating transformation at the local level in the countries in Latin America, Africa, Asia. So this is, for example, one of the activities. And we from our side are speaking with the management of this initiative, saying, seeing if indeed some modifications for the courses would need to be done to enable mentoring of the young people to engage in transformative activities on the basis of the theories provided by these courses. If some modification could be done, we could do it. It's one of the interesting examples of how young people are taking advantage of our presence in the UN and international system to plug them into different upscaling initiatives. So, but from our side also what is happening, we would be trying to link young people to specifically research and training and capacity development initiatives in the area of 10YFP on sustainable consumption and production, which Lisa Emilia already mentioned, to biodiversity and ecosystem services. So, and training again of the young people from the RCEs is going under ANPEZ for assessment, development of the assessment methods for ecosystem services and climate. So those are three initial ones, but what they do at the same time is work also on the principles of ESD, which they keep close to the heart. It's just a little snapshot of what's happening and what will be happening. So I hope it's adequate considering the time limit.
Thank you, Sinaida. So there's
can I just come in maybe?
Yes, a short one.
From another angle. I think the young people that she might be referring to are young people of a certain category who are able to sift through and see what is there, what and so forth in terms of the Global Action Youth Network that you are referring to. But we are looking also at young people where, before you can talk about this, there is their immediate needs that have got to be fulfilled. And this is what we are looking at. And you will find that this is a very small population compared to those that are in dire need of just bread and butter issues. So you have to start from there. That's why we are looking at those that have dropped out. And we are bringing them back as part of our second chance education. And then we are mainly concentrating, because they might not want to advance themselves in terms of maybe the qualifications, but they want a skill. So we have got to make sure that we impart, we avail that to them. And when that is done and they are at another level, then you can be talking about this.
Okay, thank you. There's a question over there.
Yes, very brief, we're knocking on to 6 o'clock. The presentation from Mongolia, I was very impressed with the framework for implementing the GAP. Can I just get some indication of how that would look like in 5 years' time with regards to some of those bold ambitions you have there.
Please.
Thank you very much. This is both ministry very ambitious. In Mongolia has adopted the green development strategy. They're all around all Mongolia. They have to use the political many papers on the Mongolia, but we will ESD project implementation. That's very happy to gap and into ESD in Mongolia.
Thank you. Anyone else? Anyone eager to say that over there? That's a question. Way back. And that's the last question for today, actually.
Okay, thank you.
So make it a good one.
Yes, I have a question that is connected to three questions, sorry. Maybe we don't need to answer all of them, but okay. The question is, first, as people that are connected to science and environment, I heard the many times in this Congress hear the phrase economic growth in a sustainable way. Do you really think that is possible? And do you really think that lifestyles that promote economic growth are still possible? Okay, and as education for development people, are you really being critical to education in this sense? Can we really develop and move forward if we are continuously not connecting the problems of lifestyles which promote economic growth? And to finish, as people, as citizens, you are also people. Is this really diversify? Are we really diversifying the voices? Are we really hearing all the voices in the structures we are creating? What about the ones that do not want to be developed?
Thank you. I think there were maybe three questions, but I think that Lisa will take the first one.
Thank you. Yes, I think the short answer is yes. We do believe it's possible to have a sustainable lifestyle, and there is a lot of different effort put into this. Obviously, it's not just going to happen. We have to work towards it. And just a concept such as circular economy, which is now discussed in the European Union, as well as other fora as well, as this concept of green economy, and I mentioned the ocean, we talk about blue economy. It might seem to be a lot of buzzwords, but it's really a lot of both financial means into it. So obviously there is actually some legitimated ground to work towards a sustainable lifestyle. And this is also what we are working on when we are implementing this global action program. And just to mention also that 2015 is really the year of decisions. We have the post-2015 agenda, which will be developed or adopted in September in the UN. And there will be one goal on educational. And that's what also why I mentioned the African decade of ocean is just one example why people need also to bring attention to the educational aspects. And that's really the foundation for change, the educational aspect, which is one goal on those 17. Another goal is on ocean, another goal is on water. There's goal on production and consumptions. And this is a tremendous effort done on a global level that are promoting sustainable development. Another meeting, why 2015 is a year of decisions, is the financial means that needs to come, of course, with all those ambitious policy framework. And that will be actually this month, is 1st of July. And there is, of course, a crucial meeting, as well as we have the big climate meeting in December. I mean, there is tremendous effort into do a sustainable lifestyle, sustainable development, because there's just no other alternative in that sense.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else want to comment? Yes, please.
Yeah. Thank you. This is I said the one sentence there. In Mongolia, in the PH program in Mongolia, there's fourth step in world in Mongolia. This is program in the pie project. This one is the green economic learning, the strategy and project. This is very important because this one, the Mongolia has the brown economy. We will change the green economy. Everybody understanding the green level, everything is the use the eco level, have to use the water and friendly environmental some products, and this you have to understanding and the ESD learning. That's we will sustainable development is the social and economy environmental. This the keywords have to use the economy green economy, and we will living well. That's understanding and everybody ESD. That's all.
Okay, thank you. And with that, we will actually end this last session of today. What we know is that this new idea of scaling up will not diminish the complexities of ESD and ESD work. On the contrary, on the good part, you know, it will force us to be more critical around what to upscale, what does it mean, how should we do it. And I think that a lot of the issues that you've been presenting and the questions address this fact. So thanks to our distinguished panelists, and thanks to all of you. Goodbye.